Okay, I think we're live.
Okay.
Okay.
So, Andre, you're going to start the beginning talk, right?
Yes. Hmm. Right. So, good evening, everyone, and welcome to our listeners of the music program featuring the art of tapu. And members' recent activities include Bard College Conference follow-up. It is a pleasure to have you all here today to enjoy it. We are now opening this fourth Yati with a guest from Switzerland, Daniel Sutter. Daniel is a 40-year-old Swiss doctor who grew up playing the piano and later the classical guitar. Over the years, he was dabbling with different other instruments and some choir singing. In 2022, he discovered the Qin for himself through the modern Qin song Upward to the Moon on YouTube. He looked up a video explanation of the Qin music notation by Juni Yeung out of curiosity. In the following winter, Qin videos reappeared in his YouTube feed, and he discovered the full beauty of all the ancient Qin music and knew he had to start playing. Since then, he is a student of Qin Strahler Shin, the only Qin teacher in Switzerland, who is herself a former student of Wen Quan. I'm not sure how to pronounce that. So, Daniel, you are the first one to play.
Thank you.
Great. Beautiful.
Thank you.
So, anyone would like to ask questions to Daniel about his performing today?
Your sound is very good. Are you going just directly through that microphone?
Yes, this one, yeah. I took some care setting everything up.
It was great, thank you.
Thank you, glad it worked.
Hey, how long do you start Qin? At 2 years, 1 year studying Qin? Or
in January.
January?
Yes.
In this year?
Yes.
I was very
obsessive at the beginning.
It's amazing. Well, it's
so
quite
how
good.
Many pieces, how many pieces have you learned?
This was the third.
Third piece, okay. What was the first one and two?
I forgot what they are called.
Do you remember how to play?
Yes.
Do you remember the first one you learned? Can you play it?
Yeah, sure.
So can you play now a little bit?
Play a few notes so we recognize.
Oh, 秋风词.
This one.
I see, that's good.
That was my first one.
Autumn wind.
Yes,
exactly.
The other one was crane, something with a crane.
With a crane?
Yeah.
Wild Can you geese. Play a little bit notes?
Or no, it was like, where'd it go? No.
I didn't know this piece. I don't know this piece.
This isn't your first instrument, though. You play guitar?
Yes, the classical guitar in my youth. It feels very similar, parts of it.
Daniel,
you
have no problem with your memory if you memorize Jiu Kuang just off the top of your head like that. So we all take our hats off to you. Maybe you can spread out your memory into different areas of Qin culture so that you have a wider base to draw on.
Yes. I want to study the classics. Mm-hmm.
Good luck. We're on the flight with you.
Can you tell us how did you learn from Miss Shen? Like, did you learn from one person in person, like you go to her place?
Yes.
Or you learn from on the internet?
First, I looked the YouTube videos. I also saw the video of Juni where she explained how the system works. And but then for the first lesson, I went to her, but it was she's across the other side of the country. So it took me 3 hours to get there. And then she lent me her instrument or one of her instruments. And from then on, we mostly did online sessions like this.
Mm. Are you in Geneva?
In Bern. How did she conduct the class?
Sorry?
In Bern. It's not all the way across. She's in St. Gallen and I'm in Bern.
More specifically, how did she conduct the class?
She just sits across and has her own instrument. Or what?
Yes.
What do you mean? Yeah.
Well, I mean, do you play together or do you play first and then she corrects you, or does she play first so you can listen?
Usually she gives me the notes and she has recordings of herself playing the song. And then I can use that. And then I try to do it as closely as possible. And then she corrects the technique or mistakes.
So she start with a piece of music or she start only with hand like right hand, no, then left hand.
Where's the book? She has a system from some other teacher in China that starts with very basic techniques, but are already, they're like etudes where you play simple melodies, and then more and more techniques come into play. And then the one I played before, that was the first song, the first real song.
Right.
But it builds up really well, I think.
Yes.
I do have a question for Daniel. What's my question? How old is this teacher? 30, 40s? Young, right?
Yes. I think she's in her 40s.
When she teaches, does she have some lecture notes that she prepared to teach? If not, does she teach based on someone else, Qin handbook, something like this?
Yes. I can quickly fetch the book.
It must be magic, Mingmei. Why magic? I don't understand. He's a fast learner, that's very clear. Oh, that's for sure, yeah.
Sorry, I didn't find it. Yeah, but
you don't have the book, right? You know there is a person called Switzerland, a veteran chin player called Jean-Marc. Do you know about him?
No.
So your teacher actually is not the only teacher.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
I'm trying to say?
Yeah.
He's a veteran chin player. I think he's in his 70s now.
Oh, okay.
He's been Switzerland, yeah.
Do you know where he lives?
He lives outside of Geneva. And I think I just heard that he's retired and maybe actually in his 80s.
No, I don't think he's that old yet. No, I don't think he's that old. Maybe 70s. Yeah, mid 70s. I don't think he's 80s. Yeah. He also learned from my chin teacher. Yeah, so we were friends. Yeah,
we will have a real
life. Published several books.
We will have a Yaji in Zurich soon. Maybe he will be there.
Yeah. But I don't. Maybe he's not very. Like, I don't think he joins a lot of social chin activities. I don't think so. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but you can try to contact him if you want to. I'm just telling you, he's not, I mean, your teacher is not the only one.
Oh, sorry. Yes.
No, you don't have to apologize.
The only one I was able to find on the internet.
Maybe the acting one,
yeah. So I assume, that's why I assume your teacher must be very young. I mean, the young active people, not the older generation. That's it. That's my question.
Thank you, Mingmei. Thank you, Daniel.
Yeah, thank you for listening.
So.
Thank you. The next one, Juni Yeung, play O Canada. He makes some comments about it. Sorry, my microphone was muted. The next one is Juni Yeung, playing O Canada, and makes some comments about it to complete her talk for the last meeting. So
hello, everyone. Again, last month, I was giving a talk about the potential and perhaps the need for a heptatonically tuned nine-stringed instrument, and that I was working previously on national anthems, and I realized just how hard it was adapting national anthems to the Qin, because, as you know, most of them are written in 19th to 20th century using basically Western composition methods and of different ethnic tones and designs. None of which, of course, many of which are in Western composition involving accidentals and stuff. Thankfully, that's not the case for the Canadian national anthem. And this one, so I managed to sort of squeeze it in to the Qin using an external tuning, which allows the Qin to have at least six tones Old Canada here, I have it in the Shang or the Qiliang tuning, which is the same tuning you use for playing Hua Xu Yin or Li Yi Sao and so forth. Tighten second and fifth strings. So here we, let's see, tighten fifth. Then tighten second. So the piece is quite short and also quite simple in that it only uses seven notes, not really a use of accidentals and so forth. And what you don't find with harmonics, you can sort of stuff it with a close note, a harmonic a note, or you can use press stop sounds, which I will demonstrate now. So sorry about that rather janky little bit in the middle. So you can see that a lot of the accidentals, the little sharps and flats that isn't a five, are basically placed as stop notes, which is fine and all if you want just to get the piece across. But sometimes that means having awkward situations where you're playing one section harmonics, and then suddenly you have to adapt using pressed notes in strange positions that, if you're unfamiliar with, might be strange positions that you have to press on a string in general, especially if you're classically trained for the Qin, which is usually a pentatonic plus the two flats that we have. So all in all, I think that by having a heptatonically tuned instrument, we can have a few more choices when it comes to having more harmonic sounds for those odds, as well as adding more possibilities so that we don't have to press on positions that may be unfamiliar to us as a classically tuned, classically trained Qin player. So that's the short of it. Open up for questions.
Well, my first reaction is that as soon as you have a nine-string Qin, everything is going to be unfamiliar, unless you're—
Of course, because first of all, your first unfamiliarity is that your set A, your first Xian Wong like strings four, that will—
You're just contradicting yourself. You just said that it would not, that you could do these things without—
Everything is spaced one more string apart, but aside from that, the system is the same.
I can only see it being the same if you still have it tuned pentatonically, and
it's not tuned pentatonically. I'm having extra strings. I'm tuning.
Everything will be different.
Well, the system is the same. I'm saying that the only thing that will be different is that you'll be pressing for the semitones. For example, and small semitones like these, they will become a bit larger, a bit more space, and you don't have to use tones all the time because there is no way you can have a non-stop note right now for semitones like that. And you can possibly have that when you have a heptatonically tuned instrument playing with harmonics. In fact, there are several major adaptations in Canada rendition right now. First of all, the opening line, which is the last line from O Canada, the harmonics. This is actually raised 1/4 from the rest of the song. So it's not actually in the same key as the rest of the piece. So that's one of the compromises that I had to pull. The second compromise is that I spaced out the phrases to the same standards as that of a traditional Qin player would understand it. If someone who's familiar with singing O Canada in ball games, for example, would probably find that why am I spacing out the phrases so much? Between each sentence, there's actually a big pause, but that is something to the traditional Qin player, fine, and we're used to it. So that's the second big change I've had for this rendition.
But I think that from everything I feel about this is that, yes, you can play some things better, but the traditional repertoire, you're going to have to completely return it. You can't play the traditional repertoire.
Yes, yeah, so playing traditional repertoire in a new tuning would take quite a reconfiguration because you are talking about slipping new strings in between strings 2 and 3 and 5 and 6. But I'm suggesting this new system and the heptatonic tuning system for the sake of something new. I'm suggesting that if you a modern heptatonic piece, or if you wanted to play, say, Jiang Hui, you know.
Well, you're still gonna have your original, you're gonna have two instruments, so you're okay.
System.
You definitely
it's have- a new purpose. Oh dear.
It's a new instrument, yeah.
Yes, it will be effectively a new instrument because it will be used for a different purpose with a different tuning system, but you can still adapt it using traditional tuning systems. It can still be tuned at the same time pentatonically, or that you only use 7 strings. Not that you can't do that.
Do you plan to build one?
Sorry, what was that question?
Do you plan to build one 9-string chain? Someone hires to build?
Already having it built in China right now as we speak. And I'm just waiting for it to basically finish. However, I am working more towards the software side of things. So I'm more concerned with my own expertise, at least, on getting the tuning system and, you know, the external tunings, internal tuning stuff, system in place, and to perhaps create a few example melodies, exemplifying the function and use of this new system or systems.
So you say someone is building a 9-string chain in China right now, right?
Yes. And of course, I also have a few.
Are we going to be able to see it?
Own instruments, and that may include a 9-string chin. But really, the important thing.
See it?
Oh, unfortunately, I don't. Alan, are you on the line? Alan Yip, is from our maker. He's the middleman who's organizing it all, so I have to ask him.
I see.
Yeah.
Looking forward to it. One day we can see it.
Me too. I am mostly to having the chins ready so that I can demonstrate the theoretical potential of the. So as of right now, I'm working on paper at least, pretty much, and that's it. But I am confident that this system, provided we have a working instrument, will fly pretty well, and it will serve a good purpose for adapting modern pieces, which may require more finesse than just simply pressing microtones on a stop string with our current configuration. Because really, modern composers don't understand a pentatonic instrument as well as they think. And I'm giving them some will require less conversion for them.
Just that up at Bard College last year, whatever it was, these conservatory people were playing all kinds of music that was not pentatonic.
Yes.
It was, I imagine all of it was not just diatonic, but atonal and so forth.
Mm-hmm. But not they, just they, that.
They were all
when it comes to
all
on playing the chin.
Seven string chins.
Right. When they're creating something, when composing, I suppose we've heard about the story from last Yaji, I think, where composers basically stuff to the chin player, here, I have a score, now play this. I don't care what tuning it's in. I don't care what fingering position it's in. You figure that out yourself, and it can be different every time. And I, for one, am aghast at the idea that the reason why they're saying it is because they have total lack of understanding of the chin and its potentials and the UX, the user experience for the player, for you know, working it out so that it becomes a playable state. So by having a heptatonic instrument, you would be opening up the interface to something that modern composers who are used to working in heptatonism, something that would require less conversion, and with potentially more colors for the composer and the player to work with. And I think it's not so much a nice bonus, but a necessity when it comes to translating certain pieces, especially of the modern kind. And it's Song Dynasty music and Jiang Kui and all that. I am finding more and more that the reason why this chin was not popular or continued really in the Tang and Song, distinctly different kind of from the popular banquet music of its time, is because this instrument failed to adapt to the heptatonic nature of the new music coming in at the time. So I think I am bridging that gap finally after another 1,000 years. Maybe that's Song Taizong was trying to do something like that, but then he was shot down.
I have a major problem with that because I think Song Dynasty was one of the great periods for Qin music.
If you look at Jiang Kui's other compositions, which were not for Qin, by the way, they were for the Xiao and for other instruments, they use heptatonic music plus sometimes accidentals. And without pressing onto microtonal positions on the actually play it. So what happens if you can start playing Jiang Kui music using harmonics? That would be a huge change. We can't do that right now, not with our current configuration.
Yeah, but you're on that basis, you're saying the Qin music was no, there was no popularity, or I shouldn't say popularity.
No, more like the argument back then that the Qin fell out of favor.
Where's that argument? I haven't seen that argument.
To the new music.
Where can I read that argument? I've never heard that before.
You're right. That has not come out of yet because I realized that there are no really good heptatonic pieces.
No. You said
those Jiang Kui pieces really well adapted to the Qin.
No, but you just said that it was accepted that period that the Qin music wasn't very good, and it was out of favor. Where did you get that information from?
I'm talking about the distinct lack of those eras. I'm saying that the heptatonism that we hear from Tang Song banquet music is not really well, is not present in our surviving Qin repertoire. And those that are use excessively only pressed notes. So if you look at Jie Shi Diao Youlan, you will see that he is strictly using pressed notes.
Oh, no. Youlan has a long passages in harmonics.
Yes, but also it is limited by what it can do be based on how many tones that are available with our harmonics in our current setup. I'm saying that we're trying to expand that potential.
But you said that it was generally accepted that the Qin music was not in favor during the Tang and Song dynasties. And I'm not saying why you think that. I'm asking, where did you read that? Who has said that?
Citing the Qin poet Liu Changqing's concept of, you know, 舞调虽自爱，今人多不谈. The old tunes are off the few on their own, but the modern people today, meaning those in the Tang, usually don't play it. And it illustrates a situation with the time that the Qin trust. It's Liu Changqing's poem.
Liu Changqing?
Yes.
It wasn't a poem where he's saying mourning that people don't like the old pieces from the past.
What I'm saying is that that poem had a specific historic context, in that it was illustrating that at least in the late Tang, when Liu Xiangqing was alive, that there was a huge discrepancy between Qin music and the music that was considered foreign. The music that was coming in, that was popular with the courts, as well as with the folk people. And that ran with those instruments were distinctly different from what was taught for the Qin. Because the Qin teaches like indigenous early pentatonic music theory. But then the Sui, Tang, Song, the heptatonic music theory that came in words were not really compatible. They were not really talked about in terms of the Qin. That's because the Qin is tuned pentatonically, not heptatonically. And
it's my understanding that
this instrument,
my experience is that the music from the Song Dynasty that's surviving through like Shen Qi Mi Pu, has a lot more non-pentatonicisms.
You're right. I'm talking about a completely different genre of Chinese music right here. Right. I'm talking about the Tang Yan Yue, the stuff that was written for the banquet orchestra and the stuff that was coming out from the Silk Road. And that genre of music and its temperaments and its setup is totally incompatible with the Qin, or at least so thought the scholars back then. And right now, I'm suggesting that by having a Qin that is heptatonically tuned, we might be bridging that gap.
You're saying the Qin was not popular amongst the literati during the Song Dynasty?
No. I'm saying that there is a divide amongst the literati between the old conservative faction, which supported the Qin, and those who were for the cosmopolitan foreign culture, who learned the music of the Silk Road from Sujiva and onwards. So there is two different realities of music in medieval China. And the Qin is pretty much secluded from that. Not that there isn't any attempts in portraying that kind of beyond pentatonism in the Qin. We have plenty of that, but having, there's a difference between real heptatonism. And I'm saying that the most that the Qin could do is pentatonic heptatonism. So the occasional inclusion of the two beings, but then which O Canada is, she can sort of say, is that? But then if you want to play Star Spangled Banner, for example, on the Qin, you would be hard pressed to not use excessive amounts of very small slides.
My favorite version of Star Spangled Banner is the one played by Jimi Hendrix. And I think Jimi Hendrix could well, quite well have played it on the Qin. A metal,
right, and I'm saying
metal string electronic Qin.
Mm-hmm. Well, on a pentatonic setup with our instrument, if you wanted to play it using mostly or strictly harmonics, you would be hard pressed for that. And I'm saying that by adding a few more strings in the middle, it may become more possible.
Well, it'll be fun to see your new instrument. It's going to happen, so we'll.
And I'm glad
see what happens.
John is aggressively asking all these questions, because these are indeed the burning questions we are, I'm at least trying to address here.
My question is, mm-hmm. is saying one is better than the other. If you can make a nine string Qin that catches on and people use it, that's great to have two different instruments. But don't confuse the two. It's like I think it's fine to have Qins with metal strings. Just don't confuse them with Qins that have silk strings. They're two different instruments.
But the good thing is, since these strings, you know, strings are strings after all, you can retune them to anything you want. You can still tune them classically in a pentatonic manner. So you can still use only seven strings, or you can tune it like a classical Song Dynasty nine string tuning, which is still pentatonic. Plus you just add, like, continue the cycle down or up two strings. That's basically what it is. Whether it works well or not is another different question. But then, by having the heptatonic system, which is, by the way, or you could have a suspicion that maybe someone in the Song was trying to work on it. Don't know, pure speculation. That this system is trying to solve a different question in a new domain.
Anyway, everybody had strings, I guess. I've seen six string violins lately, so everybody likes to add strings. We'll see what happens.
Mm-hmm. So ultimately, it's the software, not what I'm addressing here.
Can I ask a question? Just quick.
Hi. Okay.
Yeah. If I listen correctly, because sometimes my mind wanders, okay? So are you saying that you want to invent this nine string Qin basically to play heptatonic scale? Am I right?
On open strings, yes.
On open strings, okay. Let me write down, on open strings. And then the second question is, but what's wrong to use press or microtones to play the semitones? So why?
Because the
you have to invent two more strings.
Three types of sounds. You can only play accidentals using pressed.
What do you mean by only can play accidentals?
So semitones that are not part of a certain open strings, fifth or just in tone third. So when you have five sounds, do, re, mi, sol, la, like that, do, re, mi, sol, la. If you tune it to an external tuning, like qi liang diao, and you accidentally or intentionally, example, qi liang diao, strings 2 and 7 is one semitone apart because you didn't raise the seventh. So what that does is you would create a sixth tone on a scale.
A what tone on a scale?
You added a... And so in other words, the most you can have on a Qin, on a classically tuned internal external tuning, is six sounds because you need pairs tune your strings, tune your seven string Qin. So what I'm saying is, if you want to have a heptatonic Qin with the harmonics able to tune itself back, to its closed cycle, you need at least 9 strings. That's why I arrived at 9 strings. But to answer your question on why we needed, was it in order to?
No. My question is, what's wrong if I use press note to play the semitones? Why you have to add more strings?
If you wanted to play a certain string or a certain sound that is on the open string. Because traditional Qin music, what is the aesthetic of, why does Qin music sound like Qin music? And the answer can be answered using a court music concept, which is zheng, proper sound, match sound, the harmony sound, and the together sound. Basically, it's your xian wong, so zheng is your open string, ying is your matching sound with down a fifth, and then you press at the fifth position, which makes the unison. He is the open sound of that pressed note. Four major sounds of a Qin that you need to intersperse one with another in order to create the, which we call Qin music, that is congruent. And right now, people who are trying to create modern music or modern adaptations to the Qin are not doing, because they do not have that full array of available positions or available strings to create that full gamut of timbres and pitches together. Get what I'm saying?
Okay. I think about it, I might have more questions, but that's it for now. Thank you.
Thank you.
Very interesting. Looking forward to it.
Thank you. We need to move on. Thank you, Juni. Thank you. So the next one is myself. I'm going to put here. I will share my presentation. Just a second. It's here. And first of all, there is one thing I like to share with you, that this is a work in process, tapu. I think that tapu is not only a result that we achieve at some time by some path we have taken, but I think this is a kind of, you need to live with a piece with a long time to understand not just rhythms but melody, but the meaning too. This is pretty obvious, I think. And so this is my beginning, or the beginning of my long process of tapu. I think that I will maybe reach a term in this work in 2 years, I believe. Because we have a lot of things to do, not just play, but analyze every structure on the piece, the meaning, the words, the poem, the illustration, and choose paths among this. Yep. So just a brief note. Ta Hu Tia, the Long Nomad Reed Pipe, tells the story of Tsai Ying, daughter of Tsai Yong, a Chinese composer, poet, and writer who lived during the late Eastern Han Dynasty. She lived 12 years as a captive of the Xiongnu until 207, when the warlord Cao Cao, who controlled the Han central government in the final years of Eastern Han, paid a heavy ransom to bring her back to the Han territory, I believe because she is the last one of her house. I'm not sure about this, but I think she is the last survival. So, although it has been said that Tsai Ying himself composed this song, its authorship is still up for debate among scholars. However, the music is often credited to the great Tang Dynasty player Tong Qingliang, as John said in his website. The piece has 18 sections organized as episodes that open with words extracted from the long poem, The 18 Blasts of the Nomad Reed Pipe, written by Liao Shen, a Tang dynast who lived during the reign of Emperor Shantong. The piece, stamped by the poem lines, evokes the sentiments of desolation, solitude, and despair, not only, but mainly. Thus, moved by it, we can hear the sand, wind, frost, and slits drawing on the surface of the soundboard. For example, the following picture. This is only a metaphor to understand what I'm trying to do, that grasp the meaning of the words attached in the poem and transform it then into a gesture, or I can explain a reverse mode. The gesture on Qin, the expressivity, I don't know if this word is the right one, but the gesture is the for me is the foundation of the Qin technique or Qin playing, not the, how can I say? I will develop this concept along my presentation, okay? So, this is just a small cut. I cut this sheet music, but I will move on to take next the same score. The 18 blasts of the Nomad Reed Pipe. My recreation, or tapu, is based on the poem's appreciation concerning the meaning of the words in the English version, especially the verses that are affixed at the beginning of every section. I translate them into Portuguese to apprehend also the meanings in my native language, to get a full-field comprehension of the excerpts. I consider the whole line of each referred stanza, not just the four or five characters, but to get the meaning more accurate. I pay my attention to the essential and representative images that hover over this piece. The frosted wind, the yellow sands, the nomad sky, which are very repeated along the poem, and mostly the nomad sky. Also the profound emotions that are expressed constantly, such as grief, mourning, despair, and redemption by a motherhood. This is the finest sentiment in this piece, I believe. The way she, find herself as mother, and after that, with great melancholy, because her children must left with the nomad tribe. Here is just a sentence in the first section. In Portuguese, sound like this. Pobre de mim, uma mulher indefesa, arrastada ao pó dos bárbaros. In English, alas, a helpless woman carried away into the alien's dust. I felt this is a very strong phrase, a very strong verse. And I try to grasp in the meaning. I know that's very hard to relate the lines with, like John said, this is rarely the title and subtitles match with the melodies. We need to do an extra, extra job to trying to enter in the soul of the poem and the music and see what is fit and what is not. So that's why I translate to Portuguese also to have more emotional, bonds with this music, I think. A side note about tapu. I see tapu as a continually working process. Like I said at the beginning, we play a piece for many years to realize that we have been constructing a path to discover how to recreate old melodies. I do that considering the boundaries I need to have to flow the river down the hill. This is just a metaphor for the tradition, I believe, or the Qin transmission. the river flow to other places, like here in Brazil, a place very far from China, very far from ancient culture. But I still believe that it's possible to, I don't know, feel the waters reaching here. This is only the beginning of an enduring process of study. So this is a partial result, I believe. This is my brief analysis about what I'm sad about meaning and structure, because I have this need to see structure and music and see to detach analytical elements to understand the development of some of the development about the composition itself. So I use this kind of word, episodic, recursive, but just for me, the piece has an episodic and recursive organization, always returning to the exact opening phrase and the same melodies, gestures, and rhythmic cadence, which it has a lot of cadence here. The most characteristic gesture resembles the sweeping wind of the open string around the fifth strings animated by Fu, consisting of 7th vowels or plucks, to which 3 more are sometimes added or suppressed, making 20 pluckings that lead to the 5th string back. These gestures use the whole open strings. We can see 4 structures here, just an abstraction, okay? Just a way I see it, not the universal statement, but we can see 4 structures compound by 2 string sets, 1 to 4th and 4th to 7th. They are fitted together in a dispute around centrality, around the 4th and 5th open strings, intersected by the 2nd open string. I update my presentation here, then after the meeting I will send again with this, for example. Here's the first page of the music. Where, what I see here at the beginning is this gesture here. It's a pretty common Qin music, but in that context, is very, very strong. I believe it has a strong meaning if we read the poem and play a piece, read again, play it again, read again, you do that a lot of time, try to understand the connection between two, and plus the line here, the verse with 4 characters. So the dust, the woman who was carried away into the alien dust, for me it's the beginning of the music on this point. We have this opening, I believe, a melancholic chant, very beautiful. I will play this as this, and then you just listen to. Further, I can play again with my camera open, just for our appreciation, I believe. Just a second. We check my phone. I think it's okay. The piece starts like this. First section, and then the second one. It's the final of the second section, and then we enter on the third with the main theme. Or not theme, but gesture. That, I think, it ends here. And then we will enter in another scene, I believe. What we have here, we have a loneliness at the beginning with double stops or double strings. We have also some interval structures that are constantly repeat on that music, the third, the fourth, or just the sound between the fourth string and seventh string with very recursive thing, some sort of device for composition. We have the wind with fu, but also we have this. Just double stops between pressed seven against or in harmony with the fifth. And then fourth, open fourth, with sixth on ninth way. If you will pay attention closely, we will relate this with the technique, repeated notes that we will have a lot in this piece. We can see that some techniques that you are playing this piece has an origin at the first section, I believe. I always think that Qin pieces has some sort of, I don't know, this is just me, some sort of key at the beginning to understand the whole piece. I think it's just a belief in myself, but I try to enter in a new piece like this, playing the first section a lot to understand what is the main gesture, what is the main character into that defines a piece. I believe that somehow it makes sense most of the time. And then I tend to be more like this, to play the first, the second, the third, and then again, and relate the material, the first and second sections or third sections, to the next one. Here I found another thing very interesting about the tapu, about the just the reading, the rhythm, that we have here in this arpeggio with 70 vowels or blockings. Until here, we have some sort of, I think, a division in four, or just a binary division, very simple, or very, not simple, but common, like four notes in one beat, for example. But here, the composer or the tradition of many masters that, I don't know, play this piece and make some reviews, we have to play with ko here on fifth. But I saw a lot of chain players using tiao to make tiao, go until D. But the result is a little bit different when we play with tiao or ko, even if you do in the same velocity and the same speed. Because the intention of the player to reach the strong beat or the upbeat is always very different. So just a second, I will stop sharing just to show this. Oh, sorry. Background here, no, okay. So when I do that, have here four notes of four string played in just one beat. Four notes, one beat. And then 50, 60, 70 comes and go. We can count 1, 2, 3, 4. Wait a little bit after 5th string and then 60. Five. This is result in 8 plucking. And then double stop and here call and then again the same rhythm of the beginning of this opening phrase. And then finally the 5th string. Some chin players play like this. And tiao. But it's not the same because we changed the strong beat or the strong accent we need to have here with T. You can try yourselves later. So I noticed that and start to thinking about why we have this, how to say, this reverence, I think, about fingering. Why we cannot change in fingering? This is something that most of chin players want to do, I think. And students generally do that because they just forget how to play or because they find more interesting change fingerings or just adjust some fingering to feel the music differently. But it comes with, I think, a problem, an issue about the meaning of the phrase. I think this is just a supposition. So this is the open page. I am moving forward. So I'm trying to understand this. I try to understand these basic sets. And like I said, by a combination of four first strings fitted in one beat with accent in the fifth string just after, followed by the second set rhythmically fitted into two beats. But it's okay, we can change that. When we hit the fifth strings at the end of the consecutive 20 pluckings, it acquires the function of suspending movement and dissolving tensions. This is how I feel. It's not a universal statement, but I feel like this, that we are walking around the fifth strings and then create a resolution. When we create a resolution, we hit again the fifth string with thumb and then with ring finger and start another scene. Here, something that I read said, I call motif, but we can call, I think, with another good term, I don't know which one, that appears repeatedly in this music. We have this. And then. And cadence. We have this a lot. I feel that it comes from the beginning. Like I said. And the meaning of that, what this tiny melody or slide, what it represent? Honestly, I don't know, but I try to create a whole picture of every section, try to express the feeling, I presume, behind this. So I will jump here, then I play again, no problem. Here the opening phrase that I talked. Following this technical approach, I would say the DNA of this piece is contained in this sequence, the three added blackings on the 6th and 7th strings included, okay, plus the initial lament at the beginning. Lament because remember someone crying for me. Especially the thrice repeat double stops that I play two or three times for you, that ended the first section. It extensively uses Qin techniques, repeated and recombined to create different soundscapes, provide different paths that lead to highlight the 4th and the 5th string as central. Among many, we highlight Fu 8 times, Zhengzuo 13 times, and Beisuo a lot of 10 times. Also, it has many cadential rhythmic formulas, mainly at the end of sections, as Jiazuo Shenshen, I do not speak correctly, but we have 14 of that. In several combinations, sometimes sawing together periods or phrases that differ in meaning in direction. This is something very useful because I tend to see here a structural meaning for callus, not only finish a section, but change the color, change the range, then change the set of strings or notes. It's a kind of, I don't know, a regulator inside the piece. A changer, I don't know, I need to find a proper term. They are 28, we have a lot of this in this piece. The first sweeping wind of the open strings animated by Fu, I just repeat here, has 10 occurrences, appearing at the beginning of the each section, from the 3rd onwards to the 5th section, except the 8th and the 13th sections, which have characteristic lesions. I noticed that the first lesion occurs around the 2nd strings, connect the 7th and the 8th sections, alternate ring finger to the tongue, between 10 and 8.5 way. I will play this, okay? Reaching the lowest range of the chin, for me, revealing the darkest soundscape and color of the piece. Follow it by a stretched pedal. This come from Western analysis pedal. I know that. Okay, I just using here to refer some sort of device that occurs in this music to regain energy until the 9th section, where the piece changed to the higher ranges and high positions. Darkness against light. Here the score. We have this here at the 9th section. Oh, sorry. Here, the 8th section. We don't have this open phrase. We have just a cadence here on the 2nd string with 4th. Oh, sorry. Yeah, that's it. And then we enter in another section. We have some kind of lesion here that I believe I will just my understanding, okay? It has a function of a structural function into this music, because we see that again the same use, the cadence. The opening phrase is dismissed, and we create an illusion to, I think, to maintain the same mood, or just to not to break so much the emotional ambience of the music. I wonder after the first time I play, I forgot to play this cadence, this rhythmic cadence, and just play like this. Okay. And then moving forward, which feels, I feel very natural, then, it has a cadence here. So we see this again here. On the 13th section, here, we don't have this opening phrase again. We have cadence, but we have another kind of elision with harmonics. Not harmonics, but the fifth string plucked two times here, just after the lines from the poem, and entering another section with very different, and I think mainly played at the second set of strings, so just the fifth, sixth, and seventh strings. And why the piece end the 12th section using fourth and pressed one? It's the first set for me, and then why? And I start to perceive that we need to go deeper in the structure of the music to see this kind of thing, and try to understand the meaning, the structural meaning, plus the emotional meaning of the piece. And my conclusion, in general, I try to be more flexible with musical time, to follow the images behind the music, more reflective than painful, as someone that by written provide their cure. The reading of the poem transmits to me the utter need to survive despite all the misery she had to face. That's why I did not need to attend to a rigid rhythmic pulse. However, I restrain myself from playing at the free tempo. The rhythmic cadences helped me a lot with that. In every section, I put my fingers on strings to feel the mournful heartbeat trying to revive herself, who she was to escape death. This is just I conclude in this way, using, I think, a metaphor language, or just more poetic, because it makes sense for me that the goal in that music, or any music I believe, is the emotion, or just the mood. And we can discuss this a lot, of course. Let me stop here. And I open to questions. I can play a little bit, but I didn't... I'm not so satisfied with the result yet from section 10 onwards, but I can play, but I need to study more to feel that this is good to show to other people. But I can play until 9 or 10, no problem, and we can discuss later, or just asking questions, open to questions.
Thank you, André.
Thank you.
Unfortunately, we only have 2 minutes left for you. Do you want to say something you want? Like, or does there anybody really have a question?
I had a question, but André, thank you so much for today's presentation. Much clearer and coherent than your first one. Which I really didn't understand, but you studied the score, and that's really fundamental. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Marilyn. Oh, happy birthday!
Birthday. Marilyn, today is Marilyn's birthday.
Yeah.
Birthday. Forever young.
Right. So thank you very much to André. And that is exactly the kind of dapu report that I had asked so many people to, you know, do in the my textbook, which I try to say that if you really want to understand the purpose or the phrasing of a piece, you really should look at it from the clues of as and the little footsteps, they don't really do much. So, thank you for that analysis. That is exactly the kind of thing that every one of us should aspire to. Well done.
Thank you. Thank you, Yuni. Thank you. Very kind. So, anyone else? We need to move forward to John.
Thank you, believe. Andre.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I will call. John, it's you. Thank you.
John, you're on mute.
Can you find the microphone icon? Yeah, because
on the bottom left. Remember that Z, get your Z, hit the Z icon. Then on the bottom left.
Oh, is that it?
Okay, go.
No, you got it.
I was not looking at the screen. Anyway, maybe it's the problem is two screens. And my earphones are not working. So let's see. Okay, so I'm going to be doing this with share screen and hope it works. The host has spotlighted my video. What does that mean?
Worry about that. Just put up your sharing.
Okay.
Here you go.
Okay.
You're good.
So this is what I prepared for my presentation at Bard College. And it was a talk, and I was kind of running late, and what I ended up doing basically was this demonstration here. The talk is historically informed reconstruction from old tablature, a path to new music as well as old. And this was talking to my feeling that that there's not if you want to do new music, and Bard College is very much into new music, that they should try to learn the old music, or have the old music available for people to learn, so that the music that they're composing is not just based on the modern tradition. And I think the modern Chinese, especially the conservatory tradition, is very Western influenced. So I gave three examples of things that I have done with my reconstructions. One is this, can you see the cursor? I'm pointing at Wenjun Melody. Does that show up?
Yes, it does show up.
Probably. Okay, thank you. So one is Wenjun Melody, one is Water Tune Prelude, and one is Maudza Sings with Feeling. These are all melodies that I've reconstructed from Ming Dynasty, or in this case, just early Qing Dynasty. So the page Guqin, I have a page called Guqin Improvisation, where I discuss various types of improvisation within the Guqin tradition, and another page called Silk Qin Blues, and a section on Guqin Blues. I have used this Lovebird Blues as an example of how I've tried to learn to improvise within a musical structure. The structure being 12-bar blues. Wenjun Sao was the first melody I adapted for this purpose. It's a song that I have reconstructed and played from publication in the Function Champion of 1535. Here I will first show, so the original, I'm going to show a video. No, I will see. Here's the original poem. Yomei Renshi Jianzhi Bu Huang. And If the whole I don't see or thinking of her leads to madness, the male phoenix soars and roams over four seas searching for his mate. Unfortunately, that beautiful woman is not at this eastern wall. I use the chin in place of words. Better to express my true feelings. One day we'll see her acceptance and relieve my restless anxiety. A willing word brings me her virtue. Ah, hand in hand we have joined, we'd be joined, but if we cannot fly off together, it will cause me misery and ruin. And then there's a coda. I think people in life are seldom together, separate often. And then, so here you see those words, Yomi Renshi, Jinju Wu Wong, paired to the original melody. But as you can see here, there are no words. And this is where I've inserted additional notes or a new melody, a new phrase, here, here, and here. And thereby, this is the original melody. This changes that into a melody with a blues structure. Same thing with the second half. And then there's, in this case, this is a melody that you saw before by itself, and then I created a new melody that goes along with that. So these could be played together. The idea is that, my idea was that I was gonna learn this, and then if I met somebody who could play this, we could play together and develop variations on that, and in that way improvise together. I have a video which sort of demonstrates this, which I will. Are you hearing the music?
Yeah.
It's yes? Fine.
I have the setting. Okay, good.
Tian zhi bu wang, yi er bu jian xi, si zhi bu kuang. Feng fei hao xiang xi, si hai qiu huang. Wu nai jia ren xi, bu zai zhong jiang. Tiang qin dai yu xi liao xin dao wei tang. Er jian xu xi wei wo peng huang. Yuan yuan tei de xi, xi shu xiang jiang. Wu de yu fei xi, shi wo zai dong huang. Thank you.
There's one, so that you can see that this here, the rhythm, first place I've added words, I'm repeating words. It's still all the original words, some of the repeated. And in this version, it all starts on the upbeat. Yo, may, ren is the beat. And then I'm repeating it now with it all starting on the beat. Go back. Yeah. Okay. So some years ago I created a number of these blue structures. They will not be fully developed until I start playing them together with other interested musicians, which hasn't happened yet. I haven't tried that hard, but believe it or not, I've played that piece for some Qin players in China who know that I do old music, which sounds different from the modern tradition. And they ask, oh, is that some old melody that you're playing? Is that one of your reconstructions? They're not familiar with blues structure. Okay, so that was one. Then another one, instead of using a Western pattern, then in the next with Shri Diao Goto, I'm playing around with the idea of, well, as you say, Shri Diao Goto is the name of an old poetic form, meaning it was originally a melody, but although the melody is lost, people still write poems that fit the same structure. In theory, if the original melody were found, they could sing the new lyrics to it. A Shui Diao Goto by the famous Sung Dynasty poet Su Dong Bo has been used as lyrics for a modern pop song, most famously sung by Deng Li Jun. My Reconstruction of the Virgin, published in 1687, was in part inspired by the rhythms used in the pop song. Here the idea is, first, there's often a connection between what might be called popular or folk music and what is considered as art music. And second, perhaps using the rhythms of the popular song version to perform the 17th century Guqin melody could inspire further creative efforts using sub forms in somewhat the way we use blues structure. So here's, here are the lyrics. Ming Yue Jin Shiryo, Ba Jo Yuan Qing Tian. And I'm going to play Deng Li Jun singing this, but it's not going to be with this. This is my reconstruction. But you can see, if you look at the two together. Okay, so I tried to follow the rhythm. As you can, if you're reading the music, you can see that it didn't jibe. It's largely using a 4-4, the same as in her version. But here's my reconstruction. You'll have to excuse my singing, please.
Oh,
qi wu nong qing ying, ke si zai ren jian. Zhuan zhu ge di qi wu zhao wu mian, bu ying you huan he shi.
And the third example was a big which I've taken that melody and I've paired it with the lyrics of Matteo Ricci's Eight Songs for Western Keyboard. Matteo Ricci, a Jesuit missionary who lived in China from 1580 to 1610, brought with him a Western keyboard to present to the emperor in Beijing. For this, he created eight songs to go with the keyboard. The original music is lost, so I've paired Ricci's lyrics to my adaptation of a melody called Mozza Bega. Mozza sings with feeling, also known as Mozza Besa, which I reconstructed from a handbook published in 1609. I did this first to give an idea of what the songs might have sounded like had Ricci arranged them this way instead of with Western music, which is what generally, scholars have argued, including the director of the Conservatory of Bard. And second, I selected this melody because Mozza was a philosopher who had interested the Jesuits. Mozza wrote about love in a way which Jesuits connected to Christianity. I have plans for doing this music as part of a program called Music from the Time of Matteo Ricci, imagining Chinese and Western musicians getting together around 1600 for an elegant gathering. Although I made the setting of the eight songs so I could play it on a guqin, the intention is that this melody should then be adapted for singing with keyboard accompaniment appropriate to that era. Ideally, it will be played by someone who memorized the tune, since there's little evidence to suggest Chinese musicians were used to reading music as they played. For the singing, I have always imagined a pure tone voice as found in early Western music. There's further comment on that. So here is the beginning of the Qin melody, Mozza Bega. Dun, 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 dun. And here is my adaptation of that melody for the Ricci's Ricci's song. Now, if you compare these two, you can see that it starts da 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 octave leaps. It's the same notes without an octave leap, and that's because this is designed for the Qin, which is emphasizing different colors you can get from the melody. And here, this is more the way somebody would sing it. They wouldn't do the octave leaps, and it makes it. So the idea is somebody who's going to sing this, and then a clavichord or spinet or something like that player from that of knowing music from that period would devise accompaniment. And I have I've done this for the whole piece, but I'm going to play a video that shows how it's done for the first and second sections. Thank you. now the for the keyboard. Okay, so you can see that that was quite a bit longer than the original, but mainly there was about four lines where I inserted a similar passage, which is in the third song, I believe, or fifth song. Otherwise, there's quite a bit of repetition, playing, redoing the melody to fit words. Then here's the same thing with section two. Thank you. I happened to, while preparing for this, I did an internet search for John Thompson and Matteo Ricci. And I discovered that some people have made recordings of this. I actually knew of one that was done maybe 12 years ago, but I can't find it now. That was a choir in Germany did it, and I can't find the record of that. But on YouTube, I found two examples and a Vimeo recording here. I'm going to play this YouTube from San Francisco. You're going to see the performers themselves. If you're really interested, what you could do is you go back and listen to it and look at my lyrics. I mean, look at my transcription and you can see how they're basically doing exactly the same thing. Oops. Right. So that's basically what I did at Bard. I don't know how much time I have left. I could read my paper in about.
John, your time is actually
up.
You actually okay. Time up, so.
Yeah.
So the paper is there if anybody's interested. It's linked from my performances page.
So can we now leave question? Give time to question and answer.
I have a question, but I think I found very beautiful you singing the melodies. In very interesting the arrangements too. I think if I can I have this sheet music for study because it's difficult to see on a presentation. And if you could you share with us the sheet music?
What?
If you could share the score of this arrangement.
Let me stop sharing.
Oh, okay.
The score is on my website. For which? Are you talking about the Ricci one?
I think that's okay. I will check later and download it.
By now you should know everything's on John's website.
Pretty much everything, yeah.
I see.
It's on two different pages. One is one page is about the Mozza Bega, and there's a recording with transcription. And then on the there's a couple of Ricci pages, and one of the Ricci pages has the eight songs with my translation, some of them somebody else's translation.
It's okay. I will check later. Just because I presume that we've seen the score in a YouTube link, but it also has a sheet music. But it's wonderful. Thank you.
I have to say I was quite surprised and basically happy when I discovered that this has been people have taken it and put it on the internet. On the website, yeah. On YouTube, and so forth. But they didn't. Nobody told me about it. I don't know. I don't even know whether they got it from my website or that group that did it in Germany maybe 12 years ago. I don't know. Maybe they made a score of it and somebody found that. And it was pretty dazzling because one of them did mention that I'd done this work. But another one didn't, and it referred to me not by my normal Chinese name, but Yuehan Thompson, which is the way they transliterate John Thompson.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sometimes I'm not sure, but sometimes musicians from Baroque ensembles just feel a little afraid to contact the composer or the arrangement because of copywriting issues, so they just. You know, copying and playing.
They put it on YouTube and assume nobody's going to see it.
That's very, very interesting.
Thank you very much, John.
Thank you.
We have to move on to the next presenter, which is Esmie. Esmie is going to talk about her Taiwan trip last week.
Yeah.
Hi, how are you? Can everyone hear me? Yes?
Yes?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Okay, so I'm gonna share my screen. Okay. Well, maybe I'll make that smaller. Okay, how's that work?
Looks pretty good.
Okay. Brilliant. Just wanted to talk a little bit about my trip to Taiwan because it's been a really, really interesting experience for me. I've started playing Guqin for about 4 years now, and it has been kind of a a dream of mine that I'll be able to go to Taiwan and experience a little bit more of the traditional Chinese music and Chinese arts there. So this is a little bit of like some things that we've seen, some reflections that I've arrived to, and also about my meeting with Master Yuan. Okay, so a little bit about the trip. So the original trip was organized for back 2021, but of course COVID happened, so that had to be postponed. And after the restrictions have eased up, we picked the dates of the 4th to the 13th of April of this year. And we picked the Wanghua district to basically go to as a residence for this period of time. And for the trip, I went with my husband, so it was just the two of us. And like for those of you who are not familiar with Taipei, Wanghua district is kind of like this, I suppose one of the oldest districts in Taipei, and it's very centric, and it's got this beautiful Longshan temple as well here. So just a little bit about myself. I have been lurking around the New York Chin Society for about 3 years now, playing maybe once a year. But for those of you who don't know me or only know a little bit about me, I am a science and maths teacher in secondary school. I'm based in Ireland. I've been a Peiyou's Chin student since about 2019, and I was dabbling a little bit in the Chin a little bit before. In the picture here is the first time that I played. This is actually in London with the London Yulan Chin Society that I went to for a week in summer back in 2019. So the first time that I was playing there. I've also kind of dabbled a little bit in, Chinese drawing with the Confucius Institute, a little bit of Wei Qi and a little bit of calligraphy. As you can see, it's a work in progress, but it's there. And I am also, for about 3 years now, tried to, as best as I can, learn Chinese language so that I can access more of this beautiful culture. So that's a little bit about it and a little bit of why I also wanted to do this trip for so long. Some of my aims with this trip was to learn about a little bit more about Qin culture, to experience some things that are just not visible or accessible in Ireland because it's such a different country, to learn more about traditional Chinese music, calligraphy, drawing, also because it's a very interesting point geographically, because a lot of nature, diversity, different geoparks, volcanoes, it's got everything, and also to practice Chinese. So one of the first places that we went to was the Taipei Botanical Garden and their herbarium, which is really interesting. It's a place with a lot of beautiful biodiversity, a lot of different sort of like plants, ponds, different insects, some birds, some lizards. It's also a really, really good place for photography. Now, these are not great photographs. I'm not a photographer, but I try my best to capture how beautiful this place can be, especially around springtime. So another place that I went to pretty much on the way in the same morning was the Bayou Music Show. I've added here the link to the website in case anyone wants to check it out. And it does have an English translation in the website. So You can sort it out with Google, no problem. Now I got permission of the owner to take those pictures. So that is Dash. Here on the right hand side, we've got kind of like a selection of some of the chins that are available for purchase. This first picture here is actually all of the chin different CDs and DVDs. So you can see they've got quite the selection. I love the style of the shop. It's really kind of like beautiful, like I suppose like wardrobes, and it's just really, really nicely decorated. You can see these are kind of like mostly Qin, but some other traditional Chinese instruments, books and CDs as well. And the one in the middle at the bottom is just you know, scores and books for Qin. And on the right hand side, on the bottom is what I got from the shop. Now I wanted to get a lot more, but unfortunately there is limitations with how much I can actually bring home. So this is what I sell open. So I got this, I'm not sure if they're called cushions, pillows. They're for resting the chin in, and I didn't actually have those. I was using the, the plasticky ones, and they made such a huge difference. I got both CDs from Wuzhaoji, which I was really, really lucky to find in that shop. And I got another book for notation and for scores. I also had an opportunity to play the Qin in that shop. The song that I played was Pichaluyan. Now there was not a lot of people in the shop, so maybe 3-4 people. This was one of the chins that they had available to the public. So if anyone wants to go, you have the option to kind of like try the chins and also play in the shop. And the owner, we communicated a little bit in Chinese, and he's very enthusiastic about the chin, about people coming over and asking questions and learning about the culture. So it's a really great spot if you're in Taipei to visit, both as a cultural thing and also to get, you know, like other sort of like chin scores, books, anything really. And they do have quite a selection as well for other Chinese instruments like erhu, and they have another room where you can play them and try them out too. So that's it for Taiyue. Another place that I went to was the National Palace Museum, really kind of like big place and interesting. And I think 3-4 hours really doesn't do it justice. And you try to summarize it in 2 slides, it's very, very difficult. So some of the really kind of like interesting things that I went to see was the pottery, the drawing, the calligraphy, because those were my most particular interests. But they also had a really like really interesting selection of like sculptures and things like that. Now, out of these two, which are the most famous one, I was very unlucky because on the time that I went, the jadeite cabbage was in Tainan, so I wasn't able to see it, which was quite unfortunate, but sure, I was able to see the other one. But yeah, it's a fantastic museum with just really, really different types of art, drawings, paintings, calligraphy. I mean, there's something for everyone there. Just on the back of the museum, kind of like a little bit to the left-hand side, there is the, I'm going to pronounce it, but it's going to be wrong, it's the Qixiang Garden, is that right? And there's also a really, really nice spot. They have like this beautiful lake here, and they have little pagoda on the side where those trees are, which is in one of the other images here. And in this pagoda, I find it quite interesting. They actually have a chin table, which I'm not sure if you can bring your own chin. There was no one that I could ask about it, but you know, like might be worth to give it a try and see. I mean, there is a chin table and it's in the middle of this beautiful place. So maybe worth to give a try for the next travel if I can bring my chin. But yeah, it's a beautiful garden, and just kind of like a really relaxing atmosphere. There was not lots of people when I was there. I think kind of it was off peak. This might be a lot more busy and a lot less peaceful once summer comes in. So we went to the Chiang Kai-shek Memorial Hall as well. So in terms of the actual building, there was just there was a few kind of interesting pieces about it, especially on the outside. And on the inside, they had these painting exposition. It was called exactly like this by Lin Jiahong, and it's basically an exposition portraying like the egg, but as kind of like different part of our life. So it's a very creative exposition. It's very hard to pick like some pictures that kind of like do it justice, but I think these were my three favorite ones. As you can see, they're really kind of like interesting portrayals of the egg. Now, I do believe that the expositions do change every like few weeks, so this might not be available anymore. But yeah, this is the one that was on when we visited. Now, it does have a really, really nice kind of like garden outside as well. And we had the opportunity to sort of like feed the biodiversity, like, which is an option there as well, like it's allowed. So these are some of the pictures of some of the inhabitants of that lake, they were really kind of like friendly and human, you know, unaware. This is some like kind of like the photographs that I took, but if you're really into photography, this might be a really nice place to go as well. So we traveled, I suppose, to the northeast of the island as well, to the Geopark, which is, I suppose, one of the most popular attractions in Taiwan. I don't think I'm wrong to say that. We went in a really, really good time as well in the spring. I've heard that this place is crowded during summer times, but I was lucky enough to take all of these pictures pretty much, just waiting until someone moved, et cetera, et cetera. And I think they're really, really good pictures in that sense, but if there was a few more people, that this would have been really difficult. So definitely, if you're going to Taiwan anytime soon, spring is a great time to go. So you can see kind of like all of the different geological, like sort of like this, I want to call them potholes, but they probably do have a better scientific name. So some of these here, which are the, I suppose, mushrooms, they call them. You can see some of the fossils here in the rock. Some of these also are like interesting levels of soil. You can kind of see like the different ages and erosion caused by the tides. And this one is the frog, apparently, which kind of has like this natural frog-like appearance to it. And I really like the last picture here in the bottom on the right-hand side. It's just because it pretty much looks like what you would imagine when you say, like, when you're traveling to the moon, that it just kind of looks like all these kind of like traits, or that this is going to be any kind of like human activity. So it doesn't look like like a place that would belong in Earth. It's just so like beautiful. So definitely a place to go, probably the best off peak, so that you know, you can get all these good pictures and really enjoy it without a lot of tourists. Now, in terms of Jelio Geopark, we also did the tourist thing and took some pictures with the Queen's Head, but I have not put those up because I don't think they compare to this one, even though it's the most popular attraction, and that is because there's just too many tourists in the picture, really. Another place I went to for a couple of days was Yangmingshan, the national park. This is one of the pictures as well that I took, so that you can see sort of like to a scale, like how close you are actually able to get to this volcano. Like it's like right there. So this is kind of like the starting point of the Yangmingshan trail to the Qixing volcano. And we, on the first day that we went, we actually took the trail to Erzeping and to Mount Miantian, and we climbed it up to the top. So when we took the trail to Erzeping, you arrived to sort of like this plantation that you can see on the right hand side. And it used to be an old plantation, but now it's more of like a hiking trail. It's not in function anymore for the last over 50 years. And you can see like in this plantation, there is this lake. Now I'm sure this lake has a beautiful name to go with it, but my husband has decided to name him the Miso Soup Lake, and because of his resemblance. So that is what I'm gonna call it, the Miso Soup Lake. And some of the inhabitants that we saw along the way, like this sleeping lizard, just to show kind of like, it was also a place of really like good biodiversity, and you could see and take good pictures of it as well. And now we weren't able to see some of the like snakes that are kind of like notorious in that area, which was kind of a I suppose a downside or maybe an upside to the journey, since I am quite fond of snakes. Lizards were everywhere, so that's a plus as well. And on the top hand side, you can see the view from the Mount Miantian, which was the first of the mounts that we climbed. The trail to the Mount Miantian, I have to say, it was the first day that we did it, and we did not get lost, but at times we almost thought that we may have. It was correctly signaled, but the trail just kind of looked like it was like getting smaller and smaller, and as you were climbing the mountain, it looked like it was not a trail anymore. It just looked like some stones put like one after another, with like bamboo on both sides, and just hoping for the best that you'll arrive somewhere that you can situate yourself. But eventually we did arrive there, and the top of them of the trail was correctly signaled, so we were on the right hand track, but we were not too sure, to be honest, there. You know, a bit of an interesting experience, but definitely worth it. The second day that we went hiking, we went kind of the most common trail. Now the first time probably we went worshiping because we were trying to make sense of how to get to Mount Qixing, and I may have got a mistake with the buses. We got off on the wrong stop probably, and then it looked beautiful, so we decided to just go with it and see how it goes. So I think it went up well. But anyway, the second day, I definitely knew what the bus was about this time, so we got off the right stop and we made it to Mount Qixing. So this was what the trail looked like of the second mountain, which is a lot more open, a lot more busy as well. Some of the biodiversity that you can see, more lizards. They were very, very friendly. They would literally come up to you to sniff you. This is kind of the trail, like the open trail before you get to the bamboo that you can see in the right hand side on the top of the picture. And you can see like basically the smoke is just there. There is this smell to it. So if you're not too fond of that kind of egg smell that sulfur has, this might not be the place for you. I think despite that sulfuric kind of like smell to it, it is a beautiful place with a great kind of like biodiversity, both animals, plants. And on the right hand side here, it's just a picture of me and my husband at the top when we finally made it. And now it took a while. I even got some sympathy from some people that they told me you can do it. But eventually we did do it. And it was about an hour of just 1.6 kilometers of these steps uphill, so it is quite taxing, there's a lot of people that do this like maybe once a day or even once a week, so definitely good for your health and worth the experience if you're visiting. Now I do have to kind of like mention a couple of other places that we went to as well. Night markets quite popular in Taipei. So this one was the closest one to where we went, which was the Huaxi Night Market, which is also called the Snake Night Market. And of course, me being quite fond of snakes, being a snake owner, I kind of had to go there. And I didn't put any pictures of the snakes here because they were in jars, but it is there. And I did not eat snake, even though you can if you want to. There's a restaurant that is dedicated to that there. Couple of pictures of some of the sort of like Japanese buildings that you can see in Taipei, some of the more friendly neighborhood squirrels. And I took this picture of this tree in this alleyway because I just, it's one of the things that struck me as really, really interesting, because like in my country, at least when you go down the street, you don't see trees like this. That's quite a beautiful tree. And I'm not sure if anyone knows a little bit more about botany than perhaps I do. If anyone knows what this tree is, I would love to know. I have asked people there, but nobody knew. So as you can see, it has kind of like a really interesting root system and these kind of like hanging vines. It would be very interesting to see if there is possibility to make this a bonsai, because I think
that might be quite beautiful. And here, just another beautiful lake from one of the parks that we went to. And I've added a picture of the 101. I'm not really that into shopping, but this is one of also the most popular places in Taipei. We did go into it just to see what it was like, but there it is anyway.
Excuse me, can John mute your mic?
Like this? Better?
Oh, okay. Yeah, that noise is gone. Thank you.
Oh, I don't know what that was. I thought maybe it was I don't know, something else. Yeah. This is strange. Okay. Yeah. So then the last thing that we did in Taipei, and we were very, very lucky to have this opportunity because we were only there for a week, and the Qing Hall is in the middle of moving, so we were not too sure we were going to be able to, but on the last day, we were able to meet Master Yuan Jung-Ping in the Taipei Qing Hall. So I've added a picture here of what the Qing Hall looks like from the outside, and this is a picture of Master Yuan with Sarah and me and my husband inside of the Qing Hall. Now, one of the reasons why I really wanted to go there, apart from experiencing the Qing culture and learning more about Qing culture tradition, was because there has been, I suppose, at some point during every player, you do meet some challenges. And at this point, my challenge is a little bit to do with, struggle in integrating Qin and my daily life. And I suppose that is kind of where this gets personal. In my daily life, I always kind of feel like there is something to do, go from A to B, do this from this point to that point, like get up in the morning, go to work, have, breakfast, have lunch. There's always kind of like something to do or some goal to stray forward. And I kind of find this hard to, I suppose, stop when I'm playing Qin. So when you're playing Qin, you have to like get to a point where you have to like enjoy that silence and have patience and have concentrate and persevere. And I do struggle with those attributes because they are not something that I cultivate necessarily so much in my daily life. Maybe concentration, yes, but not so much patience. So I've always kind of struggled with these points, but at the start, the first couple of years, maybe my focus was more in like achieving those techniques, learning notation, etc., practicing the pieces. But as the technique issues are kind of like being ironed out, I do kind of start to see that this is more of a struggle from my perspective or maybe my character, and it's kind of feeling like it is holding me back. Now, when I was putting kind of together this slide, and like this picture is not, they're not my pictures. So the first one is just from the public domain, and the second one is the scholar playing the guqin from Tangyin, which is actually in the National Palace Museum in Taipei as well. And I picked those two because the first one is kind of like how my life usually kind of like can be depicted. So it's a bit of a rush hour there. And the second one is kind of like one of the pictures that we associate with Qin playing, like in the middle of nature, almost reclusive. We're playing Qin and it almost seems like there's no worries in the world. And I suppose that kind of like shows where my struggle comes from, like just integrating those two and like coming from doing all of this at work to, okay, now I'm going to practice Qin. Like, where do you leave those, I suppose, those worries? So it's one of the kind of things that I wanted to talk about with Master Yuan. And after maybe about a couple of hours of talking, like Master Yuan and I, we've kind of had a chat. Sarah was there. I have to thank at this point also André, Xiaoan, that was there for helping me translate because my Chinese, it was not up to par in this situation. It will get better, but it was not quite there yet. And So after much talking, much preparation, Master Yuan kind of gave me this this quote, and he wrote it for me in this calligraphy, which I was able to take home, and I'm currently in the process of framing. But the translation from the Chinese is, Qin is the union of me, heaven, and earth. It cultivates my body and mind, my spirit and qi. It creates a spiritual bond between me and those who understand my music. In the end, a state of absolute integrity with the universe and supreme goodness is achieved, the ultimate goal indeed. Now, this translation was obviously not done by me, so I have to thank André, and there's a link in YouTube there as well with Master Yuan explaining this quote and the significance that this quote has with the Tao as well, and how to cultivate these attributes of patience, concentration, and perseverance, which is perhaps what I need to work on to improve my Qin playing. So I was very thankful that I could do that. I'm very thankful as well for Master Yuan to give me those insights. I'm hoping that as I kind of continue my Qin practice, that I can develop those attributes and cultivate more those skills, so that I can, my Qin playing can improve. So I think I kind of have to wrap this up to some of the insights that I've gotten from my conversation with Master Yuan. And this is more or less like to synthesize what I've learned. And I could do this in like a couple of hours, but just unfortunately I have to kind of like sort of like synthesize this into a few bullet points, which it was very difficult. So I have like the Qin basically reflects what is inside. So the time, the place, and the people who listen, they are all important, which it was one of the things that they said that basically struck with me. So the time, like pick a time in the day where you feel the most, sort of like the most peaceful. And the place, have a place where you can play the Qin, where you can just get into that atmosphere. And if you don't have a place, maybe seek a place, or maybe like pick the place in your, I suppose, home probably, but if not, somewhere else where you can do that. And also the people who listen, sometimes that there might be someone, sometimes it might be that you're playing in solitude, and that is also okay. But those are all important to have this sort of like atmosphere that helps you concentrate in your playing. It is also necessary to reflect, why do you want to play the Qin and what do you hope to achieve with it? And it was one of the questions that Master Yuan asked me, and I was not expecting this question. Maybe I should have, but I wasn't. And I never really considered it for the, I suppose like the, I have my reasons for playing the Qin, but I never really kind of like thought to like outline them. I mean, I just, like when I first saw the Qin, mostly like through YouTube videos, I just fell in love with the way that the instrument sounded. So like there was no option, I had to learn it. But you know, I've kind of like, it's been 4 years, and like, do I have the same reasons now to play Qin as I did before? I mean, like, I still found the sound of the instrument of Qin extremely beautiful, especially the traditional songs, and I love to hear how that same piece is played by different schools, different people, same person in different stages of their learning life. They're all like really, really interesting things for me. And as I've learned a little bit more now, that I'm still in the very beginning of this journey, but as I've learned a little bit more about the culture, and I've I suppose improved a little bit in my drawing, calligraphy, my Qin playing, there's those reasons still stand, but they're just kind of still there, and I suppose more sort of things are being added into it. So like, why do I want to play the Qin? Because I think the Qin is beautiful, because it makes me feel more peaceful inside. And what I hope to achieve with it is that I can feel that way while playing Qin, peaceful inside, like one with the Qin all of the time. And that is just not a rare instance when I'm particularly focused and the stars are aligning. In terms of while playing the Qin, that we should aim to express our own life experience using the Qin. And this is one of the things that I particularly struggle with as being a foreigner, and that is that in teaching, we almost call it the imposter syndrome. And that is where, like, I'm playing the Qin and I'm a Qin student, but there is a part of me that kind of wonders, is it all right for me to play the Qin? This is such a Chinese traditional instrument and I'm not Chinese. And for a while, I almost felt a little bit like an imposter, like I'm learning this culture, which is not my culture, but I'm really, really interested in it. I think in this sense, as I went to Taiwan and as I've delved more and more into this culture, I've become more interested in it, and I felt less and less like, I suppose, like this imposter who's learning about something that is not their own, to someone that is falling in love with this culture and that it just wants to know more, learn more. So I think in the sense, my advice is to not kind of be like, if you are still at the stage where I was and you have these struggles that I have, to not be put off by the fact that it is not your own culture. There's nothing wrong with like studying and falling in love with another culture that is not your own. And like, in this sense, and starting up with this point is to know more about Qin history and Qin culture. It's also a way to improve your connection to the Qin and to improve your playing from that. And then one of the things that Master Yuan said that kind of have been really, really interesting and that I still have to think more about it, it's that when playing the Qin, there is what the Qin can teach you, like from the instrument, from the history from it, from the way the instrument feels when you're playing it and how the sound sounds. And there's also what you can learn yourself by like researching the Qin and researching the history, the culture, dapu, etc., etc. So those are kind of my reflections of what I've learned. I suppose at this point they are very limited by the 4 years that I've been learning the Qin, which is definitely not enough. I'm very much at the beginning of this journey, and I do think that as I go back maybe 10 years from now to this, that well, I look back and they will seem very, very silly, but this is kind of where I am now, and I think that is also all right. So I think that's kind of like the last few conclusions of how my journey have gone. So I just want to thank everyone for taking the time and listening to me going on about it. And I hope that this was helpful in one way or another to everyone. Thank you very much. And if there's any questions, I will answer them.
Any questions? Okay, so we are right now is 5:30 here in New York, so we should move on. And thank you very much, Esmie.
Thank you.
Very nice to know to see Taiwan. Beautiful photos. And okay, so the next presenter, the final one, is Mingmei. Are you there? Want to share your screen?
Actually, I just came back 2 days ago from Honolulu, so I'm still kind of jet lagged. Okay, let me share screen first. Mm-hmm. Okay, because I just didn't have time to time my talk since I just came back from a very long trip, so I might be a little bit, I hope it's not too short, not too long, okay? Just tell me when the time is up. Okay, so this talk, actually I'm to sum up what I heard and what I listened to at 2 weeks ago back college, the Qin conference. And I'm sure most of you heard about the conference, but some of you were there, including Pei Yo, John, of course, he was the participant. So this Qin conference, the title is, I put my cursor, okay. Ancient echoes and new sounds. Oh, there's a misprint here. Okay, I'm sorry, the typo, I didn't even see. Guqin in the 21st century, and I call it a groundbreaking event. You don't have to agree with me. Of course, only in the US. Let's see
why I say that. Okay. The Qin has been the literary instrument for about 3,000 years. So within this long period of time, we developed something called the Qin Dao, or the way of the Qin. It's very rich, this Qin Dao. And this way of the Qin includes many extra musical elements, such as philosophy, aesthetics, culture, mores, politics, etc. Because the literatis, they're educated scholars, right? And they are all supposed to be well-versed in Chinese philosophy and the different arts. So they add a lot of extra musical elements to the Qin. So it has become something called the Qin Dao, the way of the Qin. Of course, we have the music, basically, but we have a lot of philosophies and aesthetics surrounding the music. Literary Qin musicians are considered amateur players. They're not professionals, meaning that they play the Qin for self-cultivation and also as an elegant pastime. They do not make the Qin to make a living. In the past, now, of course, most of us teach the Qin or whatever, play the Qin to make a living, at least. Part of a living. So they have more prestige as amateur than the professional counterparts who made a living by entertaining and pleasing audiences. Actually, in the past, literary Qin players, they actually looked down upon professional court musicians, Qin musicians. Today, this lofty status of the Qin, literary Qin players is being challenged by the new conservatory-trained Qin musicians. I always tell my students, there are now very two distinct paths of the Qin. One is the literary Qin tradition, and the other is the new conservatory Qin musician. They are very, very different. They go really different ways. Okay, so that Qin music now has two paths. One is the literary, which contrasts with those of the conservatory trained Qin musicians. That is the amateurs and the professionals. However, this is not something entirely new, because in ancient time, there were also amateur scholar Qin players, notably like Confucius, and something called the Qin Dai Zhao, Qin waiting to serve. It's a professional court musician who played to accompany rituals or to entertain people. They're the professionals. So Ba's Qin conference 2 weeks ago was to address these two different paths, but the emphasis is on the new sound, ancient echoes, that means the traditional literary Qin players, and the new sound, those played by professional conservatory trained Qin musicians. So the emphasis actually is on the new sound, not on the traditional players. So Qin music performed, the new sound, is Qin music performed and composed by conservatory trained musicians and also composers. All these new pieces are composed by conservatory Qin composers. I mean, not Qin composers, conservatory composers, not by literary Qin player, because literary Qin player, like myself, we also compose Qin music, right? But all these pieces are by professionally trained composers from conservatory, not the traditional literary. Okay. My talk will be divided into two main sections. One is the scholarly presentation at Bard. I'm just kind of summarizing what they talk about. And then that's about it, okay? And then the second part is the concerts, what I learned and what I observed from the concerts. Scholarly presentations, there are five, or actually there are seven, two by students, which I don't have time to talk about. All discussing Qin playing's transition from the traditional path to the modern, okay? Mine is the first one, and the title is From Private Qin Studio to Concert Stage, Literary versus Conservatory Transmission. I focus on the teaching and the learning. So my paper examines the five modes of transmission by the literary and conservatory musicians. Actually, I gave this talk in the past at the New York Qin Society. So I will fast, I'm not going to repeat too much of what I already talked about. Number one is oral and tablature transmission. Your teacher gives you the tablature to learn, and he or she explains the tablature. So this is a tablature from my Qin teacher. Second one is oral and hand finger transmission. your teacher talk a little bit, but basically he or she demonstrate how to play. So you learn by close imitation. Heart mind transmission, that is the highest level. You just get it. You're enlightened to what you have been learning for years. Suddenly you get enlightened to it. So what is unison playing? Or we call opposite playing, 对弹. And here's a picture of me and my Qin teacher doing opposite playing. That was 30 years ago. And then moral transmission. My teacher talk a lot about being a good person. If you want to learn the Qin, you have to be a good person in the first place. And still nowadays, many people emphasize on that. And I asked the conservatory professor, Zhao Xiaoxia, I said the conservatory, since they are a professional, somewhat commercial institute, do they care about that? And she said, yes, okay. Okay, the second paper is by Hai Qing Deng, and her title is Making the Intangible Tangible. Rediscovering well-being, that's the key word, okay, through the Qin culture in Longren, China. Actually, what she's trying to say is she pointed out that the literati used the Qin to cultivate mindfulness, virtue, harmony, and all of this is to constitute well-being. So revival of the Qin is not just musical revival, but also the revival of well-being, inherited ancient Qin tradition. Just like the music, the word for music, yue, is also interpreted as le, joy. Okay. Deng, she used a case study of this Longren Qin village. I don't know how many of you have heard about this place. It's a huge enterprise dedicated to Qin culture. And this is two pictures. This is a Qin village, okay, in Zhangzhou. Okay, the discussion are in three phases. Number one is place. It's called Qin village or Qin home. And it's many, many things going on in this huge Qin village. They combine teaching the Qin, education, entrepreneurship, tourism, cultural weekend, maybe New York Qin Society in the future, can organize all the Qin players to go there to visit this Qin village. Instrumental making, they also have a library. They also have, what else? Many, oh, okay, I mean, selling Qin stuff, you know, little Qin objects, you know. So the Qin village is a spiritual sanctuary, according to Deng. This is actually her saying. I transcribed from her talk. So the English is from her talk. And functional space for the cultivation of well-being, where nature and culture can reconcile, okay? So I think I have to be quick, otherwise there's no time. So to point out, there are three different things going on in this Qin village. One is transmission. This Longren Qin village emphasis on transmission as a holistic process, okay? And also a pedagogical approach, and which, like all essence of Chinese art, emphasis on the Yi Jing, and she translated as aesthetic state. And second is emphasis on deep listening. And as we all know in Qin culture, we have this very popular word, Ji Ying. Her translation is tone knowing. That means people understand sound. And she said, this is a specialized state of consciousness. Tradition of listening in Guqing is a way of being. So in Longren village, they emphasize this deep listening of Qin. But this, I don't have time to go over. You can actually go online and get this diagram. Okay, so number three is Professor Joseph Lam's talk. And actually, I would like to ask Peyo and John, because they were there. Actually, I don't quite grasp what he tried to say. If Peyo knows, you can summarize and tell me. But I transcribed from his verbal saying. Yeah, he didn't present any slides. What he tried to say is, because Qin pieces, because the Bach concerts, a lot of modern pieces, actually, basically, they just play modern pieces. And they're very different from the old ones. So there is no point to argue which one is better. And he says, if they want to play a Qin concerto and they have fun playing it, why not? But the problem is, as I understand what he tried to say, is if they want to play a Qin concerto and they want to connect with literary elements from the Tang or Song dynasty, and Professor Lam expressed doubt whether they can connect the modern composers, really connect to tradition. as far as I understand. So he brought up the example of Zhou and Zhong's music. He said it's very new, but he has elements you can feel the Yi Jing or Chinese landscape from Zhou and Zhong's music. So Professor Lam brought up the questions such as what gets communicated and continued in the new Qin composition? Did they communicate anything traditional? Did they continue?
Hi, Mingmei. I actually watched the whole thing live online, and I actually went back and re-watched Lam's talk around 5 times. So basically, he's trying to say that he has a beef with modern composers composing pieces and then using classical titles or attributing something new to something that was traditional. So
he does not like that, right? Is that what
he
you
does
mean?
Not like the conflation of new music composed in a new style but then attributed to a continual tradition of classical playing.
That's the feeling I have, but I only listened to him once. I didn't have time, you know, because I just came back from Honolulu. That's the feeling I have, yes. So he is kind of against this, right? Are you there?
Correct.
Julie?
If you want to create something new, then do something new. But then if you're creating something
try to relate
with
tradition through the title.
Conflation.
I think one of the things at issue there was that he said that he has two sides, his academic side and his human side. And one is very different from the other. And you have to read between the lines sometimes when he's talking.
Okay.
So I think he was trying to be critical in a polite way, probably.
Oh, okay. I got it. That's why I couldn't quite get it. I listened only once. I just tried to transcribe some of his talk. So, okay, he solved my problem. So that's why he raised the question, what were the laming of Qin style? You have to study that before you compose something new, right? Or what and how did the Ming and Qing people compose? Something like this, okay. So does it fit into his title? The talk, does it fit into the title? I don't know. Okay, that's okay. I have to move on anyway. Okay, and then Zhao Xiaoxia, I have to cut short because I get some from her slides and transcribed from her talk. Is Guqin's inheritance and development the transformation of performance from traditional literary to modern age? What she tries to point out is how is the Qin music, today's Qin music is pluralism. That means you include, you know, many, many different elements and inclusiveness. Oh, I'm sorry, I talked too fast. Inclusiveness of modern Qin music, which are very different from traditional composition, which are very, very different. Okay. So she suggests that we should have integration and change, which I mean is, of course, is natural. I'm not going to read her quote because I don't think I have time. Okay. Performance technique. Okay, quote, that's what she said. Guqin performance has exceeded the traditional performance concept, which is true, started to innovate performance awareness and technology from the perspective of contemporary music and work forms. Okay, John Juni or Peiyo or anyone else. Did she really mention anything about what is performance awareness? Does anyone get the idea of what she meant by performance awareness?
I think it's the traditional form of playing, you know, the scholarly, the escape from worldly kinds of aesthetic and mindset is stripped away layer by layer, bit by bit into something more of the intentions of a modern composer and modern musician. And then we are able from there employ new techniques like electric distortion, synth, all kinds of new funky ways of altering the sound.
Okay, thank you, I need to move on. But it's still, question is, does it have a difference? Is there a difference between traditional performance awareness and a modern? We talk about that later. Okay, she lists several characteristics of modern Qin music, which I will talk about later. Composite timbre, chords composed of three notes, dense rhythmic pattern, sound, timbre, okay? As you said, the creation of contemporary works also represents trend of increasing complexity, which is completely correct, compared to ancient music. Actually, it's also very different. This is reflected in the range of speed, I think, Sumerian tempo, I guess, variation of time signature, and a complex use of rhythmic patterns. Okay, so continue to point out pluralism and inclusiveness of the aesthetic of Qin performance, harmony and diversity in the cross-cultural context, 和而不同, that I we have to think about that. History and present, inheritance of Guqin art and culture, transformation and presentation, development of Guqin performance and contemporary stage, significance of Guqin communication on world stage. Okay, so I go on. And John Thompson, of course, he already presented his whole paper now, so I'm not going to do any summarize. Okay, the second important area I want to kind of introduce for those who haven't been to the BART conference is the concerts, the Qin concerts, with all new compositions, almost. There might be four traditional pieces played. One is by my student, graduate student, during her lecture recital. She played Moji Bei Shi, I think, no, Qiu Hong, and another one, I forget which one. Okay, so there are about two or three traditional pieces played. Excuse me, the rest are all modern compositions. Okay, concerts with new composition. There are three major Qin concerts. Most are new pieces. The oldest was composed in 1984. So we can go over this very quickly. One is called Ancient Dance, Trace, Ode to Farewell, Light, Rain, that use like traditional poems, but it's a new piece. Bai He, Maneuver, Sound from the Heart, Sing Lai, a four picture. This is based on a famous Qing Ming Dynasty painting. Four picture of white geese. Okay, Zhao, Qin and German music. Okay, all of this. The last one is One Ecstasy. Actually, it's based on Jun Kuáng with the whole orchestra. Okay, so about how many? About nine new pieces. I might left out some, remind me if I did. Okay, I want to mention about only one piece because I don't have time to talk about most of the pieces that I'm interested in. The one that I like the best, I guess, finding more interesting, is this one called Bai He. Among, not seven, it's nine, okay? I personally find Bai He Maneuver the most interesting. It was inspired by the chapter Bai He opening and closing of the 4th century book Gui Guji. It explains, this is a quote, okay, not my writing. It explains the art of maneuvering to unite or divide political coalitions and expands the open-closed dichotomy into a universal principle. The Chinese is here from the Gui Guji. The composer shows his relationship through a Guqin duet, there are two Guqin playing. Composer Liu Tangqi said, the two Qins represent two learned, equally powerful scholars using Gui Guji's philosophy of opening, closing, or you advance or you retreat, all those dualistic, you know, elements to survive and thrive in this dualistic world. Okay, the composer Liu added a new timbre to Qin music. Right, because we have the harmonics, we have the satin, the open tones, we have the presto. He added a new timbre, which is the wood, knocking on the wood, the many, many knockings on the wood. Actually, to me, it's a little bit too many after a while, after the excitement. To the piece, by the use of frequent knockings on the chin spot to express arguments, quarreling between people, or one try to maneuver or convince the other side, as well as eloquent dialogue or conversation, which are very interesting. The new wood tone colors include play knocking, fist knocking, finger joint knocking, hit knocking, fist knocking, joint knocking, palm knocking, many different kinds, okay? This new fingering adds new audio and visual impact. It's atonal, of course, the knock is no melody, like percussion, you know, percussionistic, and also pointillism, because it's all points, there's no lines, which are new to Qin music. Okay, let me show a few videos of this knocking. Just a moment, because I don't know how to put the actual recording onto my share screen, so I only show you from my cell phone, okay? Very short. Can you see? It's not, is it working? No.
No, you have to stop sharing your screen so we can see.
Oh, really? I didn't know that. Oh, wait. I have to stop share screen to show that video?
Yeah, unless you have the video on your
screen. No, I don't. Okay, let me stop share now, okay?
Or maybe, yeah.
Okay,
it's quick anyway. Share another screen with the link.
Oh, we cannot hear the sound though.
Oh, really? I can hear myself.
Of course
I can. Try original sound, original sound on.
Yeah, my sound is on, yeah.
Yeah, from your cell phone, it's hard for us to hear.
I'm so sorry because I really don't have time. I just went back for 2 days.
That's okay.
To learn how to put that onto the...
Can you
send me
the conference itself, right? Do you have the time index?
No. It's too hard to find it now. But my sound is not mute. You can't hear at all?
It's just from cell phone... Maybe you have to put next to your microphone.
Oh, where's my microphone? I have no idea. Where's my microphone?
Dear.
Where is my... I don't even know where is my microphone.
Don't worry.
Oh, my God.
Mingmei, you can send me that link later. I can post on the...
Oh, you can see the hand gesture.
Oh, there it goes. Move it a little bit further away, Mingmei. I heard something for a second.
Right.
Okay.
I don't know.
Okay. At least you know something about it. Okay. Let me go back.
They have this on their website.
Yeah, maybe. I don't
know. They do. So if you have the time index of when it happened, can actually find it.
Yeah, we'll organize it later. We'll figure it out.
Okay. So it's all this knocking, which is a new addition of tone color to Qin music that we didn't have before. But I'm sure this knocking on the chin is not the first time from this composition that must be used in the past, okay? Okay, so I only have time to talk about this piece. And I summarize characteristics of new Qin composition, okay, as the following. Okay, number one, changing meter. Is it? Okay, changing meter. Okay, constantly changing. Look at this one. How many are... if you are able to play this, change, constantly changing, and not only that, you have to play with the piano too, okay? So it's very, very difficult. These new pieces are not easy at all. I think they're more difficult than traditional pieces, most traditional pieces. And very dense rhythmic pattern, like this one. And this one, of course, traditional pieces, we have that too, like this one. New use of fingerings. And this one, I don't have an example for now, okay? They use, because the Qin always play with another instrument, either the piano, an ensemble, a whole orchestra, or a flute, or some Chinese musical instrument. So in order not for the Qin sound to be overwhelmed, completely covered up by the other instruments, they have to do a lot of loud fingerings. So in many pieces, I don't remember which one, they do a lot of porqi, you know, the porqi, guanfu, mainly from the open tones because they're louder, okay? A lot of p, like the swaying with the fingering. And also quick succession of more tail, but constantly like this to add to the sound volume and also the speed. So a lot of the new use of fingerings. The fingerings are not traditional, but a lot of this kind of use, okay? And a lot of... but not a lot, but some new fingerings and also new symbols and new pieces. Of course, I mean, this is a new symbol. The arrow in Bie Fu, Ode to Farewell, use the thumb and ring finger to press on the sixth and seventh string to glide up and then down. You see, you know, glide up and then glide down and glide up. And this kind of thing was not used in traditional tablature. And this one is the guanfu, and then use this kind of long, it's an arrow, I can't really tell. But anyway, some new symbols which were not used in traditional repertoire. And this one is interesting, it's guwu. anyone can decide what this symbol is. I asked my student because they actually play this piece. And then they said this D notes, it just repeat. You see all this, it just keep repeating, continuously repeated. And this is from slow, like, is it 8th or 16th note, and then the 30th note, and then back to slow from fast, slow, fast, and then slow again. So this kind are really new symbols, right? Or new way of using the five-staff notation to indicate qin. And this one is this kind of symbol to illustrate, to play the tiao and pi continuously very fast, okay? So these are all new symbols. And if you have noticed, except this one, none of this modern qin score has any qin notation on it. Have you noticed that? This part is by the qin, but no qin tablature, okay? And which part, I don't have my glasses on. This is by the qin, but no qin tablature. And this is something very interesting. Okay, and let me see what else. Okay, so this is another new symbol, and new tunings. 这个叫竖吧，这个琴, and you can, I'm not going to read it out, so you can, but the most interesting is this one, sound of the heart, xin lai, because there are two qins tuned differently. One qin is used the zheng diao, so la, do, re, mi, so la, and then the other is use this, I don't know what to call it, okay, this tuning. Okay, think about it. If you have two qin, because it's a qin duet, one is the zheng diao and the other is another unusual tuning, not those traditional qin tuning. How do you work together? Is there any difficulty? I never played this kind
of
music.
I can see what they're doing. They're basically using two qins to try to cover four notes. They're covering for each other for strings and tunes that their own qin cannot cover on their own, because there's only a limit of seven strings.
Yeah.
In other words, they're trying to slip in extra strings.
Using another tuning of another qin.
Yes. Slip in semitones, which is one of the criticisms I have of, you know, existing chin design and
I got it.
Like these.
Yeah, I got it. But okay. Okay. So, but this is unusual for me because, of course, traditionally we never play something like that, not even close, right? And then they use chords, and they put under quotation is because can you really play chords on the chin? Can anyone tell me, can you play chords on the chin? That means at least three notes, right? Can you do that on a qin?
Technically, it has been done already, even in traditional repertoire. But
yeah,
it is
who?
Very
by who?
Rare.
What is the name of the piece?
Hmm?
You said it has been done. What is the name of the piece?
I can't even remember which traditional piece is like actually play three notes together.
But it can't be for too long,
right?
It is
1, 3, and 6.
Mm-hmm.
And
I don't know of it. I don't know of any. I've looked at a lot of Ming tablature. I've never seen it.
John, you said you've never seen any traditional pieces using chord, three notes, right?
I never know.
Wait, okay. Cheng Gongliang. Could it be? Cheng Gongliang's Po Xiu Luo Lan somewhere.
But it's a new piece. It's not a traditional piece.
Well, it's true. But then a Po Xiu Luo.
But it's a new piece. A new piece, you can do anything. I'm talking about traditional pieces.
Right.
Yeah, a new piece, of course. I mean, this one, okay. But even
they're written usually as a broke, like one note on top of a cuo or a yuan lo. And then it's written
as but that's a little bit different. If you really play a chord, you cannot imitate the piano. I mean, piano, you can play five, right? Six, seven notes at the same time. Qin, I really don't think you can do that. It's just one time, it's okay. Just one note, and that's it, no more. But you want to variation and move along. I don't think you can do that. It's just too hard.
Session, no that is
what is the point? Mm-hmm. What is the point? Okay. But in ancient dance, they supposed to have something. Where is the chin part? Let me see. It's the gu qin. You see this? Did you see this?
Wish I have their tablature. I can
this
see
is supposed
words,
to
but I don't see any tablature.
No, they don't do tablature. The modern chin compositions have no chin tablature. They're all five staff notation. They're all five staff notation. So this one is supposed by the chin, right? How many notes here? It's the clusters of notes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Can you play that on the chin? No, I don't think so, okay? So ask my student what they said, if I heard correctly, okay? But I have to ask them again. They said, of course, you can't play seven notes on the chin and then continuously like that too, right? I don't think it's possible. And then, okay. So what they told me is they use the P, the tall, the P fingering to play quickly in succession. And a cluster of notes, something like this, okay? Like many notes together. So it sounds like some kind of chords, okay?
That's right. You could have five chins, that'd be one way.
That's as far as I understand, okay? Okay, and another characteristic is they have a lot of new form, right? Do it with another chin or with other Chinese or Western instrument. Most commonly is chin and piano, chin and flute, chin and another chin or what else, okay? A chin concerto, you know, with the whole Western orchestra or Chinese orchestra, that's pretty common now already. However, the one thing is very interesting, no chin solo. That means the modern composer from the conservatory, they almost never composed a chin solo as a modern chin piece. It's all chin with other instruments. And
ensembles.
Tell me why. Guess why? Tell me why.
I have my theory, and that is that the chin by itself with metal strings is not that interesting color-wise.
I have almost the exact same answer, but it's composition itself is lacking in the three colors of the chin, the open, the pressed, and the harmonic, and they're not interspersed correctly to make it sound full enough as chin music as it is.
Wait. Why is it? I don't understand. Juni, can you say again? What makes you think that they don't compose chin solo?
Listen to any classical chin music. It's always interspersed with an open string and then some pressed notes.
Yes.
Or there are sections of harmonics sometimes interspersed with open sounds.
Yes.
And then you finish with a pressed. The new compositions do not allow for that kind of rich yun building in that it just sounds like a modern zheng piece in that it falls flat on the ground if played solo.
I still don't get it. The conservatory, they don't compose chin solo and they compose all this chin with other instruments. Why don't they compose chin solo? Your explanation doesn't quite make sense to me.
They can't play it, and that is true. Because they don't understand the importance of yun in order to...
Yun, you mean the sheng yun, the yun. Sheng yun,
yes.
The yun. Oh, okay.
Yes, this is the Chinese. The yun,
the
one.
No, I...
They
yeah, but
build
it's
up
not
the
that...
full music to it because they don't give the time for it because they are so concentrated on building the cluster of tightly packed for building
yeah,
more tension.
But on the other hand, they still can compose a solo piece with no yun. They have the freedom to do whatever they want. It's still a solo piece, modern composed, but no yun. They can do that.
Of course they can. Whether it's judged in a positive light by our community is a different question.
No, I don't think they care what other people think. They really don't care. They do what they want, really. They just do what they want. So it's interesting.
Should I leave the next? Oh, sorry. Back up with the tuning the instruments that they have. Notice that there are certain patterns or there is a formula to the chaos. And I want to make a comment at that, but I will leave that for the question section.
Okay. So another very interesting thing is all the modern pieces, they will make it as technically challenging as possible. Okay. Because that I can understand, because they want to compete with the piano or something composed by Liszt. They just want to make the Qin as virtuosic an instrument as possible, so the Qin can compete with any other instruments on the concert stage, on the world's concert stage. And I don't object to that, because there's a lot to be explored, sonic possibilities of the Qin, finger possibilities. There are many, many to be explored. So the conservatory composers, they're exploring all this as much as they could for now, okay? So there still may be still something new in the future to be explored. So another thing is that they're technically very extremely challenging. And I look at some of the scores, I think some pieces like the, which one is that? Is it or the Baihe, the one with the knocking? Very, very difficult. I think they're even more difficult than Xiaosang Shui Wen in technique-wise, okay? I'm not talking about the I Ching, those kind of metaphysical thing. They're really very, very difficult, more than the Xiaosang Shui Wen, more than Guang Ling San. Very, very difficult and challenging. And then they are on this path to be even more difficult, more challenging technically in the future, and more virtuoso, until they go to a point they can't move on anymore. That's what I think. They might come back and then do something more like traditional. So I conclude. So this modern Qin path, it happened. You like it or not, it happened. It is there, whether you like it or not, because I have some friends, they're really, really against this kind of modern Qin composition, okay? Because actually one of my friends, they just don't like this kind of style, especially a more older generation, traditional, really trained literary Qin player. You like it or not, it is there, and it will continue. How long, I don't know, okay? But to my surprise, I do like these new pieces. The first time I heard it, the first night is the students concert, I said, oh, wow, I like it. I don't know why, but I really like it. Okay, I said, surprisingly, I like it is because I belong to the older generation of Qin musicians, right? I'm not the young people who grew up with the digital world, if you listen to a lot of electric Qin or amplified, modified Qin sound. I am the older generation of Qin musicians, and I'm trained is traditional literary style, which emphasis on the style of Qin Wei Dan Yuan, okay? Purity, subtlety, no subtlety in the modern Qin music, right? Very little, all bang on your head, okay? Very passionate, bursting with energy, blandness and remoteness. So the new compositions are very, very different from this. But I do like it. Why? Because I feel a different kind of energy. I just feel differently. You have an open mind. Or another kind of traditional aesthetic, which we call zhongzheng heping. We use the pentatonic scale, which is very zhongzheng heping, very balanced, very centered, harmonious and peaceful, right? And these new Qin composers are very, very different. This manner of playing is intended for, the literary manner of playing, intended for meditation, cultivation. We go inside to look at ourselves, but this new Qin composers, you go outside to look at the world, to explore the world, completely different kinds of energy. And actually, I like both, okay? So this is very contrasting to the conservatory style, which is very animated, very exciting, bursting with energy, which also strive for technical challenge and excitement. So let me show you a last video on my cell phone. I hope you can see something. Maybe some of you have heard of this before, and give me 2 minutes to find, because since I have to find it on my cell phone. Bear with me a few minutes. Let me find this. I'm just technically, I'm kind of maybe high school.
Off note, Mingmei, will you be sharing this document that you are sharing on the screen right now sometime later in the open? Because I would like to cite some of the information in here, the upcoming paper I'm writing.
Actually, I intend to publish as a paper first in China in some kind of Chinese music magazine. Yeah, But this one I wrote in
I
English.
Need first.
But if you quote, you just said you quote from me, that's okay. Yeah.
Yeah. And second, I just need the account of the tunings or yeah, the modes that
they're
using.
I can send it to you. Yeah, no problem.
Excellent.
Bear with me 2 more minutes until I find it, because this is very interesting. That's why I think I need to share it with you, but it's I'm so bad, okay? I'm sorry. You can discuss why I'm finding for that video. I'm sorry. I think I'm almost there. Okay. Oh, okay, here, okay. So should I stop sharing now? Share screen?
Yes.
Stop, okay. This is a very virtuosic and very modern piece, but not the one played at any of the one played at Bach. It's something.
Cannot hear.
Try moving it around. Move it around a little bit, mate. Mingmei.
No sound.
Better if you have a link and then share it with us. Or if it's saved on your phone, then that could be more difficult.
The sound is being filtered out.
Yeah, I'm not sure why, but it's not working.
So, Mingmei, where can we find this?
That's probably an MP3 file.
Yeah, I can't hear you. Where I finished?
Only you can hear it, we cannot hear it.
We really need to get Mingmei hooked up onto 2 PCs so that she can share content.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you. Peo, what did you say?
Yeah, it didn't
work.
We
cannot hear. So we don't hear anything.
Oh, no sound at all?
No, I'm sorry.
But how come you hear me? You can't hear this.
Yeah, we can figure it out. You may have a setting that it may think it's noise for some reason and trying to get
through. It is noise. There's a lot of noise.
So where can we find it? Do you know?
Let me try to think where I can find it. Oh, there is an online. Is it a Qin conference? And someone sent a link to me, someone from China.
But that must be a file on your cell phone. Just download the file.
Yeah, but that's what I so use for my cell phone. So I use my cell phone. I don't know how to cut that from the Zoom link. So I use my cell phone to videotape.
Yeah,
this
just mail it to Peo or me, and we'll get it up somehow.
Okay. It's not very good quality because I film it with my cell phone from a Zoom link. You know what I mean?
Yeah, don't worry.
And so it's not very good quality, but it's to show you first. Can you hear any melody? No. I think it's completely atonal, okay? And it's very, very virtuosic. And it's very, what do you call it? It's to the extreme, right? It's to the extreme. And it's completely contrast to traditional tune pieces like Ping Sa Luo Yan, O Lu Wang Ji, Mei Hua San.
Does that piece have a name?
Yeah, but I don't remember now. I have to look up for my in my file. Because I can't put the name onto my cell phone, so I don't know today. There is a name. But I suspect a lot is improvisation. You know what I mean? That there is no notation, because you can't notate those. It's improvised. They indicate, the composer indicate this, you just do this, guazhou or whatever, okay? Improvised. And I forget to say, and the modern Qin composition actually, there are a lot of improvisational elements in it, much more than traditional. There are a lot. It just let the performer kind of like free to do something. There are a lot of that.
They write down their compositions, but they're really designed for playing live and making recordings, video recordings. It's not really composition in the same sense that we're used to, where you write the composition down and then it could be reproduced. I don't think they intend anyone to reperform what they're doing. You play it once and that's it.
They'll be lost as soon as the composer stops playing or forgets it or doesn't pass it on, which is one of the greatest criticisms to contemporary Qin music because it is not reproducible?
That's exactly what
I was thinking about that. I did ask people asked around the composers, you know, the professionally trained and conservatory composers, how many, because most don't really play the Qin as an expert, you know what I mean? You know, okay. So I asked how many do play the Qin, I mean, a real Qin player, and then they're also composers learning composition at the conservatory. And I was told there are actually a few now, they really master Qin players, you know, they learn all the traditional pieces. And my student told me there's one who can play like Xiao Xiang Shou very well. And he was the one who composed, which one? I forget now. He was the one who composed, I don't remember which piece is the composed, but he or she did learn the Qin well, and then he composed this piece, which was performed abroad, I mean, but I forget which one. And so my student told me, that's why when they play that particular piece, it's very smooth, because the composer actually knows about the Qin, and he actually, master or not, I don't know, but he actually played up to Xiao Xiang Shui, and that means he's very advanced Qin student. So there are composers now who really learn the Qin and play it. So we expect a lot of these composers in the future who can compose modern Qin pieces and see what we can get and or see whether we like it or not. Okay. So, okay, that's the end of my talk. Thank you very much. And
wonderful. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. And if you still have any questions, because we already kind of interact a lot during my talk. So if you still have any questions, please feel free to ask me.
Maybe later, yeah. This is a lot of information. Very
interesting. Yeah, it's a lot to absorb, even for myself.
So yeah, I've already asked for that report. And I just noticed that they're trying to do things basically like what our countries in the West have been trying to do with new music in the 70s, 80s, 90s.
Yes, of course, needless to say, they're catching up with Western music. And also one important thing is they want to do anything that was not done traditionally. That they don't want to repeat anything traditionally had already done. So they want to explore new things, new sonic possibilities.
The only downside I find is still the huge discommunication between the performer, in that there is absolutely no consideration for the interface of our instrument. There's nothing written to it. Everything is handed over to us and it becomes irreproducible in future.
I don't know how to look at that, because don't forget, this kind of new composition are very, very new. 30 years later, 50 years later, I will no longer be here. What will happen? The good one will survive always, okay? And the not so good one. And there is a piece I don't have time to play. It's called called traces in Chinese. Shuo, that means to trace back, something like this. Completely atonal. And the first time, of course, I didn't like it at all, because I still like pieces with melodies, right? Because that's more enjoyable. And then my student told me, it's keep changing meter constantly. So I think those pieces actually are very, very difficult to play, very, very challenging. And I hope you guys will try one or two of those pieces to play. I will try one, see how I feel about it. But I look at the notation, it's very, very difficult. It's much more difficult even than Guanglingshan, Xiao Shang Shou, and all those big pieces. Or more difficult than 那个公益写了一个曲嘛, 叫春风, the spring breeze, right? When it first came out, it's supposedly to be technically very challenging. But when you know this kind of modern pieces, 春风 is an easy piece, you know what I mean?
Yes. Because
those are all easy pieces.
Or the modality really. Of their compositions as well. They're intentionally making it hard by using Aeolian and Locrian modes. But then there's a huge disconnect there because these are heptatonic modal systems. But they're trying to force it upon a pentatonic instrument with a pentatonic interface. So the reason why I'm suggesting we need a heptatonic interface for them is so that they have something more native to work on, or else they're just going to, or they're intentionally lopping off important parts of their modality just to make it sort of work, or to adapt onto things which are, when forced upon the Qin performer, they will find to be impossible to do. They'll be looking for harmonics which cannot exist one Qin with one tuning. That's why you have the second with a second set of strings that can create stuff. Otherwise, you would have Dr. Victor Zhe Zhenyan has with his composition, was it Shang Yi or Zhi Yi, with the artificial harmonic. You can't play it within one sitting. You have to retune your strings and record just that one sound. Otherwise, it would not be reproducible on a Qin. It's just
okay.
That.
It's very interesting observation, but I need to ask my students or the composers whether it is because what you think. That's why they have two different tunings. I want to ask what they think or what their intention. Maybe they want two different tunings just to explore something new. What you think is strings. What happened to other people? Like, what do other people think now? Because Juni said is they use the heptatonic piece forced on the pentatonic instrument. What do other people think about this?
Well, I just think they can use seven string Qin to make those amazing difficult composition. That means Qin can do it.
That's what I think. They can do it. Yeah,
nine string, the seven string can do it. Right. But I
think they could do better.
I just think, is this become a trend in the future that Qin will go this direction?
What direction? What direction?
The complicated composition.
Of course. It will not stop for a long time. I tell you that. Yeah. It will go on and on for a long, long time.
And how do you think, Mingmei? Are you afraid? Are you afraid of this trend?
No, not at all. Not at all. I mean, to be honest, I can't play those pieces. I look at the notation, they're so complex. You almost faint, right? Yeah, I can maybe spend 2-3 years to learn it and memorize and perform, but what's the point? I mean, I'm this age, I'm not going to learn that kind of
thing. If it's any kind of compensation or reassurance to you, Peiyo, there is a movement now called new classical movement. So in the wave of new music that's being tried in conservatories, the atonalism, the out breaking the walls boundary kind of thing, there is a resurgence of mock or imitation classical or Baroque that's newly composed today, that is tonal, that is rational, that is classical in the sense.
But yeah, I'm sure there will be a comeback. But so what is this group? Is it a conservatory?
There will be a similar movement in the Qin.
But is it from the conservatory people?
Hard to say, but
once they get out of the conservatory sometimes.
Yeah. Pop music is a part of this neoclassical movement. Because tonal music and marketable music is often classical in a sense of accepted tonal old music that is accepted as a norm. So I'm expecting to see that even with all these new techniques, they will use these new techniques and new compositional methods, perhaps with new instruments, to create classical sounding compositions in the future that will have a bit more of that level that is above and beyond achieved from this era of experimentation. That is what I'll see in the next 20 years.
I don't worry about that personally because, as I said, the good composition, the really good ones, which touch you here or appeal to your intellect, we just stay. The bad one, after a while, people play for maybe 2-3 times, they just drop those pieces. So in 50 years, which will stay, then they are good pieces. I don't worry about that. But technically they're really challenging. So how to put it?
So not professional trained Qin player.
Yeah, it's hard. If you're not professionally trained in a conservatory, it's very hard to play those pieces. It is very hard. Mm. I try to find a notation and show you guys a few pages, but I couldn't find it. I download some notation. It's very, very complex. You just can't imagine how complex it is.
I suspect this is largely academic at the moment. I look again quickly on YouTube, I don't see much sign of music like this appearing there. Not to say that everything is on YouTube, but lots of things are on YouTube.
Usually, you have to search them up for specific concert names or piece names, and in Chinese.
I'm saying this. It's clearly it's a niche at the moment. That's all I'm saying.
Probably. Yeah. The YouTube can still show you what's the population likes, right?
But that's why I emphasize is there are two paths. One is conservatory Qin music. Yeah. And the others, the literati, they can't even cross, in my opinion.
Yeah.
They can't even cross.
And in the middle, you have marketable stuff, pop.
But don't forget, conservatory, they have their own resource. They have their own resource. I said, if as a literati Qin player, let's say, okay, I compose a piece, I want to play with the whole orchestra. I'm very, very good, okay? I can play with the whole orchestra. But where do you find the orchestra?
Yeah, like I have
at your hand. You can't. If you're in the conservatory, you're the staff or you're the student, you play with the orchestra. It's right there for you. But literally, you don't have that resource. You don't have the connection. You just can't do it, even if you're very, very good.
I have a friend, music. Anyway, music from China every year. Susan Cheng, they commission some new music. But I can't say it's very popular. I go, but it's not a popular thing to do in the U.S. at least. But they do it. I can show you. This isn't for Guqin, but for other Chinese instruments. So I'm familiar with this type of thing. But there's some composers who are pretty well known who have a modern style. But I wouldn't say it's more academic than popular. You know, that's all I'm observing.
I think my favorite program up at Bard was the one by Gao Hong. Peepaw player from conservatory training who was playing with, she's playing with
harp.
Harp and
oud.
A harp and oud. And I think the training that you get in a conservatory allows you to do stuff like that once you can escape from the conservatory.
Mm-hmm. They actually, about Qin students I'm talking about, they are trained to sight read. Mm. We are not trained to sight read. And sight I'm not teaching my students to sight read.
Traditional Qin notation?
No, not modern, of course, modern.
Oh, the Western.
Yeah, they just sight read a lot. So they're very, very good. Yeah, they're really good. Yeah. So, I teach my private students, I'm not to teach them sight read, right?
I have to say we're way over time and I actually need to leave.
So. Oh, okay. That's fine. Okay.
Right, yes. Okay. Yeah, it's 6:30 now.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mingmei. Thank you, everyone.
Okay, welcome. Oh, it'll be a good discussion today.
Yes,
okay.
Thank you.
So, thank you, everyone.
I'm going to stop here now.
Okay, bye-bye. Thank you, everyone. Bye.
Thank you, Rob.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks, Payal. Bye.